this, they'll probably try to lock him in a top pick very early on so that he can deal with Mac Noon and have that rumble for the mid game or the Lissandra, depending on what's left up.
Well, we're going to have to see. I think there's a couple games to play here. You could ban the Lee Sin or you could ban the Lucian. And again, pinch one of these picks because you, I think, expect Rumble to go through. Now they're going to ban Xerath. They just removed Jess's champion pool. Five mid lane bans in this game. Huhi losing a lot of his individual playmakers. Jess is losing the only individualistic champion he has. And then the Xerath, who was so strong last time.
I like this from Fusion because they leave up Lissandra. They leave up the Rumble. They leave up the Lee Sin.
Yeah.
You're going to get two of those.
Here's the weird thing, though, is like, Jarvan and Lee Sin are both great. Rumble and Lissandra, yeah, both great. You've got Corki and Lucian, who are both kind of these pairs off. Like, you've got a lot of just, like, quickly traded back-and-forth champions. I'm trying to think what, if anything, is even isolated. What really needs to be first pick because there's an equivalent somewhere right next to it.
Yeah, Corki, Lucian.
I mean,
exactly.
That said, Jarvan was more important, yeah, than Lee Sin was. That ends up getting first pick, Mac Noon. Now, does he want Lissandra? Maybe does Huhi want Lissandra? Do they want Rumble there? I don't know if you want to give away Rumble Jarvan.
Rumble Jarvan is an extremely potent composition, and they are going to go for it. And it looks like it's just going to be more of the same here from Coast if they do lock that in for themselves.
Now, what this does help, though, is Mac Noon has been targeted very heavily so far throughout the games. Just Coast puts a lot of effort onto him. They believe him to be the only reason, not the only reason, but like the biggest member of Fusion, the most important member of Fusion, the main reason they win, and they've been holding him down. And when he's on a champion who needs farm like Maokai, it wasn't very pretty. When he was on Rumble, whatever, the items come through anyway. You don't need very many. Mac Noon on Lissandra will be very safe, much harder to gank. We've seen a lot of failed dives against Lissandra. That actually might work to stymie a lot of the plans of Coast.
Yeah, and again, Niantonso gets the Corki in the first round of picks for them.
Sure.
Like, just the amount of prioritization they put on that champion, but it also could be a flex pick for them, is the thing. Like, if you give it over to Mash, that might allow Jezzes to play, like, Ezreal, or maybe he can play the Corki mid. Mm-hmm. Like, I guess that might be why they're taking it away. I'm trying to go for a stretch here, because there's just so much prioritization on it for Niantonso, and he does play Lucian, too.
Right. Well, here's the thing, that you can see that Coast are kind of, I feel like they're ahead of the curve right here, right? They grab the early Jarvan. They're seemingly not concerned about Lissandra right here. In fact, I don't think Coast themselves banned Lissandra into the games yet, so I don't know if they personally care too much. I forget who banned it earlier on in the series. But the fact that they're grabbing the early Janna, certainly they don't care about Thresh anymore, but that was contested back and forth. Like, Fusion are still living in Corki's important land, and Coast don't care anymore. I wonder if Coast have solved this champ select game way faster than Fusion have, or if Fusion was right all along, and these picks end up mattering a whole bunch more than we're expecting.
Yeah, and Janna's kind of Sheep's fallback champion for him, and it also just accelerates your laning phase. Like, a Thresh is really good for picking, but Janna is really good for trading.
Yeah, and we saw that. I mean, yeah, we saw how strong Lucian Janna was, and in fact, keeping Mash safe has been great. Giving him 50 bonus attack damage has been great as well. Fusion actually are going to go for the double AD comp, though. They're actually going to grab the Ezreal away as well. The Elise comes in. We know their entire comp aside from the support. And I'm actually surprised Ezreal came through, unless they thought Mash might have stolen that. But I bet you he would have gotten Lucian anyway.
Yeah, I don't know. Like, he has played the Ezreal in the bottom lane multiple times. But them picking that up for themselves in the mid lane for Huhi, it's not as roam-oriented a champion as he likes. It does have a mid-late game power spike for him, depending on what build he goes with and how much he's left alone to just charge up his tier and become kind of this. It's very poke oriented. It's kind of a big thing here with his composition. It's poke oriented, like they want to whittle you down and then get in there and all in you.
Ooh, whoa.
Impaler.
Is this the top Jarvan again?
Top Jarvan.
Saw it before.
So I talked to a couple people. Top Jarvan is supposedly the counter pick to Lissandra.
Okay.
Like, Lissandra and Maokai, or sorry, Maokai does like pretty well against Lissandra. Lissandra apparently doesn't do very well against Jarvan. You have to, like, all in, and you can stop him. You can knock him up while he's using Glacial Path. You can all in him and just keep trading.
So that was the entire reason for those early picks,
then? That's what I've been told.
Okay, no, and if that's the case, then that's why the first pick Jarvan came through. They knew Lissandra was left up. They knew Mac Noon was likely to go for it. If not, Jarvan just goes to the jungle, and who cares? That's why they left this Rengar, this assumed jungle pick for last, and Kosa put this comp together. Their hard engage is a freaking incredible, by the way. Rengar Orianna is ludicrous. We saw that a bunch throughout Worlds, and it was super effective.
It's the ball of yarn combo.
Yeah, pretty much.
Give the ball to the kitty, and it goes crazy.
1 second left. The Lugabru is going to go for Alistar as his support pick. So taking some time on this one.
The disengage, or at least the split up. Yeah, the engage, disengage.
So Fusion can craft the type of fights they want. Now, they've got a lot of engage potential with Glacial Tomb and stuff from Macron's Lissandra, as well as his Elise from Nintendo. And his Elise was quite good, I felt, in Game 2, I think it was, that he was playing it. Glebe Glarbu's Alistar, we haven't seen it too much recently, but it's a champion I have to respect a whole bunch. And Fusion running a double AD comp with a whole bunch of CC and sort of safety and peel for this team. Coast, a lot of hard engage.
Yeah, this is going to be a lot of physical damage here, so Macnoon is going to be somebody that they have to kind of lock down and make it only a physical-oriented composition and then build around that on Coast side. But there is mixed damage from Corki, of course.
Right.
So that allows the double AD to operate. Then Coast side is just Wombo combo.
Yeah. It's a bunch of Wombo combo, and then just in case, Mash is kind of kept safe by Sheep's Janna here. At the very least, even though a lot of people say, oh, you know, Janna's disengage support, why would you pick it with a bunch of hard engage? Well, you still have a plus 50 attack damage shield that makes your AD carry crush when everyone else is locked down. And I think it's a really good option to go for. It should be a whole bunch of fun. Now, Coast looking to play a bunch of hard engage. They've got a decent mid-game team fight ahead of them. We'll see if these guys can do it or if Fusion can finally close this series out. Now, guys, if you want to join the conversation online, head over to Twitter. Tweet at LOL Esports. Use that hashtag LCS expansion. Let us know what you are thinking about these games. They've been great so far. We've got one or two left, and at the end of it, we're going to have a new LCS team for us. Fusion up 2-1 in the best of five. Coast, so far, firing back.
You know what I really like about this tournament, just as a whole, is there hasn't been a 3-0.
Not a single one.
There has not been a single 3-0.
Yeah.
It's all been 3-1s, 3-2s. Really enjoy that. Really enjoy the quality of these teams and these games that they're putting out there.
Yeah.
And also kind of experimenting on 4.20 in a competitive environment.
Yeah, it's been fun watching these series. They have been close. There's been more parody than a pirate ship. And Team Coast, Parrot,
Oh, God.
You said it, and I was like, I'm ready for this.
I didn't get it at first.
That's the problem with bad puns.
I wish I had never gotten it.
It's like a fruitcake. It's like, thanks for the gift, but I'm just going to re-gift it on. I don't really want this. Team Fusion, though, looking for the 3-1 victory. We're just going to get ourselves in the game. We're going to ignore the fact that I'm not very funny. And Fusion, in a death brush. One more win, they join the LCS. Team Coast need the reverse sweep. They've done one so far. And for the first Rengar we're seeing in a little while, can they make it another?
Sheep playing it safe.
You know, one thing that's interesting about Rengar is...
Ooh, that's a good one.
Throughout season 2014... Ooh, nice move. They're going to kill it. They reveal themselves. They revealed everybody. Okay. So throughout 2014, Rengars were running move speed quints because there was so little move speed on the ulti. You just needed to close into range. Like, you needed that, like, extra, like, 100 units you would gain during the ulti to actually close the gap. Now, with the 2015 changes... The jungle's really difficult, and if you run move speed quints, you get super, super low clearing the jungle camps. And I've seen over in OGN when he was getting played Rengar in this new season, he would like have to kite the wolves back on his first clear just to finish them, and like wait for cooldowns and like get that last heal going through. So I want to know how well Impaler's jungle actually goes here.
Well, he'll be able to smite this red, get some HP back, and yeah, keep tabs on that. Big thing about this Rengar is it's a champion that he really enjoys, and he can carry on. When we saw him actually in the first couple of rounds for this tournament, he had an amazing
Oh, Huhi's got to be careful. Ignites already on. Yeah, makes him chuck through potions. Now, Huhi has multiple times now. He actually goes Longsword 3 potions, so his sustain is going to be really high. But Jess has already burned both his pots. Huhi's going to burn 2. Ignite's already down. Sustain lead now goes to Huhi here. The early sort of gambit there, he didn't die, and it's going to pay off. Got to be careful with that, though.
Yeah, he's just got to stop taking damage. They were just kind of testing their metal against each other. And Orion is actually one of the better mids
He's got way more metal than Ezreal.
Yeah.
Sorry. I'll stop.
Well, it's Pulse Fire, so he's like covered in metal.
Okay, good point.
See, she still does have more, though. But yeah, to test your metal against with auto attacks, but she has that Clockwork Windup passive.
That's true. And looks like actually Impaler's done a great job. He's not really losing much health at all, so it looks like just getting a decent leech is all it needed for him to stay alive in this jungle. His smite's back up. Blue buff's going to be his. No big problem there. Nintendo is, to be fair, farming faster. He's already back, got the Trailblazer and a ward here. We'll see what else Impaler can do for himself.
Or what he can do for his team as a whole, too. But here comes Glebe. Level 2, he has Headbutt Pulverize.
I don't know if he can get Jess, though. Like, no potions, but
Jess
still,
that's safe.
I don't think he can't possibly die to this. And I don't even know if they're going to get a flash out of it.
No.
He's just too far back. Yeah, this is good game sense. Yeah. They got called out, hey, guys, there's no support bot lane. He's gone. Alistar loves to roam. I mean, nice attempt by Glebe, but really good reaction here by Jess. He even got to push in while that all happened. Like, really perfect.
Yeah, Justice is that mid lane player where you're just like, just let me kill you, and you get very frustrated at it, and it kind of makes you waste a lot of time in the bushes.
And then he three-man shockwaves you. Yes. And you're like, yep, that was the wrong call.
And you like lose track of the ball placement that he had during the fight. And that's something that I've been noticing as well, is that he gets it as far as he can, and he doesn't leash it back to himself, but he kind of just slowly moves it from like the left side to the right side.
Yeah.
And then eventually it's right under you during a team fight.
Well, so far so good. Jess is down a little bit in CS, who he's doing a great job of farming so far on Ezreal. Counter gank is already available for Impaler, and here comes the dive on in. It's going to be a 2-on-2. Nintendo comes in, a lot of CC, but
Macbeth
is going to go down.
Holy.
First blood in from Rengar. The burst is there.
Impaler flashed into the next bush to leap to him.
That was awesome. Very nicely done. Impaler makes it happen. Jess is forced away, but first blood 4 times in a row for Coast.
He's going to go straight in
and
with the bola.
Dude rooted up. Wow, heavily out damages. Can he bait Chris into the turret? Not quite. Jess is low. He goes in. Oh, the E hit a minion. Flash in. He heals himself. One auto attack Q. The W reaches. He gets him under the second turret.
The poke down, the sustain war that he ended up losing. And then he just pokes him down, pokes him down. All in.
Man, that tier 2 turret actually nearly saved Jess as well, of course. The 1 second lockout between shields nearly wasn't enough to keep Uhi from getting the kill, but hey, made it happen. So, Fusion, find a ways to fire back, but those kills were both unassisted, so they're worth actually less gold than Coast's kills were. Actually, the total kill gold is the same. It was an assisted first blood versus 2 isolated kills. It's actually the same gold here. Mash gotta be real careful. Ignite is on, he will just barely survive this, but Minion Aggro's not helping him. He's still got heal, he knew.
He has heal, yeah. But he wants to heal himself up. He's got that potion running. His auto attacks will definitely help him. But here comes Impaler. No flash available for him.
No flash. He's got 4 points of ferocity. Just the Valkyrie out. That should be decent for phage timing at least for Nian Tom. So that's an okay time to go back. I don't believe you can do BS or get on Mash.
They interrupted it.
Not good for Sheep. Knocked into the minion wave as well. Big damage. He's got to be careful. But Glebe as well. Mash flashes in. Can he get the kill? Yes, he will. And now suddenly Huhi in a 3-on-1 against Jess. This man does not have flash. He's got nowhere to go. Cocoon's going to miss. One more auto attack. There's the jump on in. MacNoon gets the kill. A 1-for-1 trade across the map.
Yeah, and MacNoon, he came from the top lane just wrapping around. And he spent a lot of time before he closed that distance onto Jess's. And then he just came out of nowhere. Didn't even have to use his TP.
Beautiful stuff, and Impaler are looking for the turret dive. Nian Tanso has no summoner spells. Nintendo about to counter gank this. He's going to run into his own tribe rush, and suddenly, ooh, he's going to check with this. Nian Tanso, Valkyrie is up. Can he buy enough time? Chris is there. There's the cocoon. There's a bunch of CC. Impaler going to be careful. Here comes MacNoon, and Coast bit off more than they could chew. Nice collapse by Fusion, 4-2 in this game.
And the fact that MacNoon didn't use his TP for the mid gank, he had it up for that bottom gank, and now they're going to start up the dragon.
And look at this forced recall. Team Coast have no resources, no summoner spells up except for a flash on Sheep. They're forced to recall away, and nobody is here to answer this dragon take. So Fusion, time and again, they go for the early dragon. This time they will not get punished for it. And Fusion, after a rough early start, are looking very good here.
Already having 8,000, almost 1,000 gold up over Coast 7 minutes into the game is really big. Impaler, you know, he comes out, but then the TP just dissuades everybody, and they swap targets to Nintendo, but he's already cocooned, and then they collapse on him, and look at that. Glacial Path to close the distance, and he's behind their turret. No flash still because he used it top for that amazing gank. Mm-hmm. Very easy cleanup there because of the mispositioning and the TP still being available.
Oh, yeah. And I mean, just great game sense by Nintendo. You saw him. He's like, okay, the support's dead. They still have 2 guys bot lane with 4 resources. They could dive on to Nian Tanso. And Nian's like, yeah, they could dive me. I'll hold on. Don't worry. And Nintendude comes around from Tri-Brush, expects the Rengar to be there. You saw him, Volatile spiraling into the brush. It gives vision. It would reveal if Rengar were there. And it's like, yep, we guessed this one right. There's the TP in. Exactly perfect. I really like how Coast... it was a nice enough by Coast, but I really like how Fusion played it.
You know, Nien sitting there as the shot caller team being very vocal, probably saying, like, they're going to dive me. They're going to dive me.
Yeah.
They're going to get me. I'm staying. And then, boom, the collapse.
Valkyrie was up. Even with no summoners, he knew he was safe enough. He did a good job. So here we go. Nice little piercing light. The poke is still coming down. This bot lane, it's not easy for Nien. He's getting pushed around a fair bit, and I think this is actually a trough for him. Fate is just objectively worse than a BF sword right now in terms of a lane fight. So Mash and Sheep doing a great job. They're denying CS. They're denying golden experience. They're making life even more difficult for Nien, who thrives on getting gold.
Yeah, he seems to operate when he's up in CS, but they just funnel a whole bunch into him. They're going to have to get this blue over, but look at that.
The flash ult. Jess is in a bad spot. He's got Shockwave, but his flash is down. Nice Shockwave, but it's not enough. Ooh, he comes in. Now, Coast were using their power spike of their bot lane, but everything else is going well.
Yeah, the four-man gank onto the mid laner of Jess is 0-3 on that Orianna, which is one of his safe champions. But now he doesn't have that Xerath, and the bans are working out for Fusion.
Oh, Nien's in a pretty bad spot. That's going to be a dead turret, and in comes the jump. He's going to Valkyrie backwards. Will it be enough? I highly doubt it. Goes in for Sheep. Not going to find enough. Coast keep fighting in the bottom lane. Fusion keep fighting everywhere else. We'll see which one ends up being worth more. Both teams going to get a turret. Top lane, Mac Noon.
He has no mana.
He's a Q away from dead. Chris pushes the wave in.
It's very close. He almost does.
Wow, Chris doesn't want to risk getting outplayed or ganked. He knows the entire mid lane's missing now. Mac Noon scrapes just on by.
Yeah, it cost 60 mana to get that Dragon Strike out. And he didn't have any more flask charges.
Oh, darn. Poor guy. Well, Chris can't quick get the kill. Mac Noon knows enough to stay safe in there. Spots the mana.
Mac Noon keeps clearing and then just leaving that top lane because he wants to cause pressure somewhere else. Chris, he just doesn't want to stay in that lane against the Jarvan.
It's really interesting when we sort of look at players and we're like, okay, guys, the record for most CS at 10 minutes. Wow, 115. Way to go, Froggen. Like, really good Karthus play. And you see, like, wow, MacNews only got 50. It's like, well, yeah, he got his team 3 kills.
Yeah.
Like, I would take that over 60 CS any day. But there's no record for that. We should celebrate that kind of stuff.
Kills
more,
at 15 minutes? I'm pretty sure China would have that record.
Pretty sure Solo Q has that record.
No.
Every single one of us has made that record.
Solo Q, oh, man.
Everyone's had that like level 1 ace from Field Invade. Everyone's had that game, you know?
Somebody like just everybody dies and the last person just dies to an ignite. It's just like we're all dead.
Yep.
It's just like everybody got a passive bonus gold.
Alright, we all started the game with we're gonna bonus gold. Let's start going to lanes, guys. Okay, so
they know Mash is alone because they saw Sheep clearing a ward.
Yeah.
Nintendo's coming down, and they're pushing this wave
pressure.
In.
Oh yeah, Nintendo comes in. Yeah, exactly. This is not a good place to be in if you're the rest of that lineup. Oh, he tried to repel to double golems, but the camp was down, so it took longer for Nintendo to come down. The wave bot already got cleared. Mash is safe, and that's not going to pay off.
Paler clearing out the Krugs himself.
Grabs the last one for a Ferocity charge. He's up 4 stacks right here. Sheep's got to be careful. Nice knockup. The flash. Ooh, Mash stays safe. Trade of flashes from Glebe. Very low health in Alistar now.
Just the pressure. They're just kind of swapping it here in terms of what junglers are doing. Impaler towards that top and mid side, whereas before, you know, he was all about that bottom side. He's just trying to spread out where he was, and Nintendo's doing the opposite, thinking, you know, Impaler might be on this side later on, but instead trying to just take advantage of a lane that didn't have a support.
Well, right now, Ward spotted Impaler running through that upper jungle. Nintendo knows this spot is safe, but no one's really around to make this dive happen.
They're backing up completely, like, even between those two turrets.
Leave course retreat. But look at this bottom lane, tier 2, still going to be going down. Mash was out of important summoner spells. His flash was gone, his ulti was down. And this is Nintendo coming down for the bottom lane push. Cannon minion will die in this turret, down to about 1/3. Nien Tonso can stay for this one. I actually have a hard time casting a team with Nintendude and Nien Tonso.
Yeah.
They're so similar, I keep getting them wrong.
I always have to stop for like a quarter second. I'm like, yeah.
Nintendude X.
Nintenso is having a great game.
Nice. Well, they are combined 2-1 and 1. Not too bad.
Nintendude.
Nintendude. Nintendude. I don't know. One of those.
Yeah, it's
they should do a lane. And Pity should play support.
No, that would absolutely be terrible. Again.
They'd be the worst bot lane ever.
Oh. Nien and Nin.
No.
Nien, Nin.
Ugh. Nine Inch Nails Dude X. I don't know.
What?
You just N-I-N. Adding, you're just and I am.
Oh, okay. Dragon live.
Yeah, and let's see. First one did go to Fusion. Team Coast. I don't know if they're well set up for this one, though. They do have Shockwave, but they just don't have a lot of damage output to back it up just yet. It's kind of a power trough for everybody. No one's, like, supposed to dominate this fight, except maybe Tiamat Jarvan is probably as spiked as any champion is in this game right now. A double AD without Triforce is really weak right now.
Yep.
They kite back, but can't kill a front line yet. But the poke is scary, and Mac Noon actually tooling them around the map, staying top lane with a teleport. In fact, there's no reason that Chris should be there. And Mac Noon gets two free waves, a bunch of turret damage, and Fusion play the map better.
And just the fact that Mac Noon, he always wants to be in these one-on-ones until he's needed. Mm-hmm. It's really his style.
Oh, that's a red buff steal by Huhi. And now Fusion get to make everybody sad about this.
They all just stopped in unison there. I was like, did we DC? It's like they all just stopped.
There's a ward inside of Dragon. They're trying to bait it, but now they've got to be pretty careful. Impaler can only flash in. He cannot flash out. He can't walk around in time either, so will he go for this? He ults, but he's not in range to make the leap.
There's a pick ward right there, though, so they see him.
Mac Noon gets jumped on, self-ults right away. Do they have the damage they need? Gleeblarbu knocked around by Sheep Dragon at one half health, but do you stay for the 2,000 health Dragon? Impaler's flash is down. There's a shockwave on the two. Catches Gleeblarbu. Down he goes. Impaler in the front lines. Will he stay? Yes, he will. Nice smite. Impaler gets Dragon number one. And a kill. Team Coast won that
fight. He's alone.
Easy pickup by Huhi. Oh, it is it! Impaler shields and heals. Mac Noon goes down too. Team Coast doing great stuff, and Nien can't find it either. Triple kill for Mash.
What a crazy fight back and forth. Impaler played that really well, just skipping of it. The Orianna ultimate was good as well from Jezz's, but the fact that it was scattered, they just couldn't capitalize.
Oh no, Fusion. They all died and then bought Trinity Forces. That they stayed out with that power trough when they had an advantage right in front of them.
Like this fight again, Mac Noon comes up, they engage on him. Then immediately, everybody's out, and Sheep disengages, and then they re-engage the fight.
And now it's too low, and Gleeb's taking free damage.
Yeah,
like,
the dragon
this.
Reset, too. And there's the shockwave onto two people. Gleeb, or one person, sorry. They get the flash.
They waited out Alistair ultimate.
They end up killing him, and then they get the smite, because Nintendo thought it was a complete disengage. Huhi comes in, gets the auto, he's burning, gets the W and the heal.
Wow. He actually tried to walk into range for the melee W. He actually didn't land it, so actually he needed to land the Q first. And then he finally got the ferocity. He was like spamming those buttons, trying to land things. Chris in a bad spot. There's the ult. He's gonna die. So nice play top lane, but there's nothing else to gain. Fusion got a kill and that's it.
And that was pretty strange to look at. That's the 413 change on Lissandra where the frozen tomb just stops you immediately, even if you're flying somewhere.
Do you stop in midair if that happens?
Yes, you can. Know it stops all move blocks. Now,
Animation, if you're like leaping somewhere, you're up in the sky.
It doesn't let you complete it.
Okay. Oh, you fall to the ground?
No, you get stuck in the mid animation. It's almost like if you're Jace hammering somebody and then you Zonya's.
Okay. So you are up in the air.
Yeah.
You're like levitating.
It stops you immediately.
I wasn't aware of that part.
Because before people would be like,
yeah, I knew you got stopped. I just didn't know if you like fell to the ground or not.
No. It doesn't change where you are. It just immediately stops you.
Okay.
So that's why he was still like with his flag extended during it.
Makes sense. The animation stopped. Impaler's like, wait a second, there was Lissandra here. She disappeared. Clawed away. All fine. Fusion equal in kills, equal in dragons, to be fair. So all Coast have done there was equalize the game. They tied it up to basically the exact same scoreline. Gold is the same. Dragon's the same. Turret's the same. You have like at most 30 CS different than any lane. That equalizes out. So this is an exactly tied game, but Fusion have double Triforce now.
Chess is looking.
No, but he's low. He's got to be careful on this one.
He doesn't get anything for it. There's the ultimate from Huhi to clear out the side wave. Trinity Force spikes are the things for Fusion. Like you said, too little too late after that dragon fight. They buy them for themselves when they really needed those right beforehand.
And it might have been like the one kill they got the ambient gold because they didn't like buy potion the Triforces. Like they just had enough money. So I think they were just short of that before Dragon anyway, but I think at that point you have to give it up or try to make a different kind of trade. Here's Rengar the intended engage. How, yeah, okay, who saw the explanation point and stayed around? Intended Shockwave onto three. Ult from Glee. Will they find any more? Looks like no. Just ulti's traded.
Here comes Chris, though.
No meaningful damage. Yeah, the thing is, Jess is so low. Like, yeah. There's no way Coast can win this kind of fight.
Chris would have to turn it, like, right now with a Cataclysm after an EQ, but
there'd be no follow-up.
Yeah, nobody would be able to do anything.
Yeah. Unless he can one-shot Huhi, who's only at about 1,000 health. But that's like trading your life for the chance that an Ezreal kill. Good poke. Turret's gonna take some damage now, and this is the big power spike. Jess is forced to heal. He's actually still in base. Fusion can kind of smell this as a 5v4, but there's still so much threat that they don't go in too hard. All right, not too much picked up. Huhi had prior ulted the bot lane.
Hey.
Well, he's back up.
Jesses went for the Mirella Namakan as opposed to the Athenes.
Fading double AD.
Against an AD. It makes perfect sense.
Cooldown boots picked up for Ezreal. Still has that tier, still stacking up. Nope. I do like Triforce before Mana Mooney, by the way.
He got
even if you're playing bot lane Ezreal.
Oh, Trinity Force? Yeah, because you're still stacking up the tier of the goddess the entire time.
It's not like you're not spamming Qs anyway.
Yeah. And not on, like, not spamming on cooldown and everything. Juggernaut was actually completed by Nintendude this game, very early on.
Yeah, last time he had Sightstone first and then went Giant's Belt. This time, Sightstone into Juggernaut.
And a big part of that is he needs to be on that front line and needs to be as healthy as he possibly can be.
Yeah, because he's the only tank.
Exactly. Well, no, Alistar's going to help him out a little bit. But the fact that there's double AD carry. Let's see, can he get it again?
Oh! Yes, he can. Two buff steals for Huhi. Nice stuff for him. He's got to feel good about this one. Getting extra blues is nice. And the question is, can they do anything with it?
He's not doing it blind. They always have wards on them.
But that's on his team,
but
like
it's
making
still
great
good
plays.
Timing of the ultimate.
That actually makes it more impressive because it means the team got ward coverage up in time.
And they're not even just contesting it by walking out there, just throwing out the ultimate, and it's working out. He's not being punished for it. He's not like blowing his ultimate before a team fight.
And that's kind of the funny thing about Smite. Is a lot of times you don't want to burn it because dragons and stuff can come up, even things that are worth smiting.
Yep. Which will be in 30 seconds here. Is that next dragon, Chris, in the top lane, further up than the minion wave, you know, just checking around.
He went up for Hydra already.
Going Impaler. For
Nintendude. Oh, Nintendude, you're in a bad spot. Repels on up, and here's the re-engage. Machnoon's there. Early ult by Alistar. I'm not sure why he went for that one. He is going to land some CC onto Chris, but Chris, honestly, not in that bad of a spot. Ulties. Sheep very, very low. Machnoon's gonna go down though. He overextends himself. Impaler walks into the back line, finds the bait for the two-man shockwave, stays alive.
My God.
Impaler making the plays, 3-0. Out goes Fusion. Now Dragon might just help these guys out. There's Repel into the air. Dragon doesn't do enough. Oh, he snipes out Corki. And out goes Nintendo. But that was a 4-0 and a Dragon for Coast. How beautiful was that?
Man, Impaler's play on that Rengar is
wow.
Yeah, that's how you would describe it. It was just, wow. You play Rengar and you're like, oh, I can do this. And then...
Can't do that.
No, you cannot. Immediately,
I can't do that.
It is so hard. The management he has, watch this. He's going to jump in onto Gleep. He's going to back up. And then eventually he goes back in. And then he swaps just the mechanics it takes. He jumps in, flashes to the bush, jumps in, goes to
Bates
the left.
Shockwave.
Goes to the bush. Jumps in again, and then he ends up. Oh
man!
Just the bush management that he has on that Rengar is something that you don't learn immediately. It doesn't come very intuitively to you because you're not always aware of how the bushes are placed in relation to each other, or like how far you can jump with it.
Yeah.
So it takes you,
hundreds learn the champion.
Of games. It takes you like tens of hundreds of games to figure that out.
Right just, there also.
Because you got to think about that during the fight, too.
No, I mean, it's really impressive to do that all instinctively. Very nicely done. Intended at the very end there had actually just missed a cocoon as well on the over-the-wall jumping mash that would have guaranteed them the trade back and not made everyone else lose their flashes and deaths. But at the end of the day, it was a 4-0, not a 3-1. Dragon secured by Coast, and they are looking very good. The reverse sweep certainly possible here. That said, Fusion still, they know their power. They know they've got that double Triforce, they should be able to siege. There's the engage by Chris. Wow, early zone is by Machnoon. I think that might have been a misclick. It ends up dodging a Shockwave, though.
Yeah, he dodged the Shockwave. Also, it was only going to be on him, and Impaler had blown his ultimate. He didn't throw the ball onto Impaler at all.
That's a lot of important spells now down by Team Coast, so Fusion can feel confident in this. No Shockwave, no Rengar ulti. The only engage is the Jarvan, and they know his flash is down. But Nash top lane, big wave, they have to clear it.
Yeah, and Nash is in really good shape, though.
This game, Nash is huge.
It's very strange how this game just keeps going, or at least this set keeps going, between one AD carries Fed, the other one is. Boom, 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 just back and forth. First two games, Niantatsu had really good games. Next two games, Nash has really good games on Lucian. So he's like, oh, we don't have to prioritize the Corki. We're good.
It's the right choice.
6-0-4 already with the Infinity Edge and the Static Shiv to just a Trinity Force.
Oh, wow. Into the enemy jungle.
Speaking of good games and bad games, you see the polarization right there.
Man, a lot of good things are happening for Team Coast. They have managed to turn themselves around in this series, and they are looking poised to take Game 4. Only 24 minutes in, but they have just made good choice after good choice over and over again. Gleeve Glarbu now also just limping into the jungle for seemingly no reason. Another kill picked up there. Nintendo forced to run away as well. They knew people got jumped on in that jungle. I don't know what's happening to Fusion right now.
Yeah, and the top lane is pushing in. They have a minion wave here to deal with this. This could be the tower going down very quickly.
And now Chris really wants to force this team away. Takes a whole bunch of damage, but Macnoon also locked up. Early Zonya's pop, not going to be a shockwave, but it is going to be a turret picked up. Gleeve Glarbu respawns in 5, but nothing Fusion can do about this. Team Coast now find their 5th turret of the game.
They're kind of falling apart at the seams here. Yeah. When they don't have a mid-game composition that like has Rumble in it and that has all these things that help them out and get past, like you, if you have an okay early game, you fall into just this pattern of, all right, let's fight around dragons and we win for Fusion. Coast has been playing those types of compositions these last two games and have been excelling with them. It seems to be all about the mid game between these two teams, because Coast has a good early game. They've got first blood, I think, every game still.
Yeah.
And then Fusion, they kind of fall apart at the start, but then they regroup when they start grouping.
Ooh, blue buff almost stolen away. Not quite, though. That does go to Team Coast finally. Mid lane, nice rotation opportunity here. Two guys are stuck on the other side of the map recalling, but Team Fusion so afraid of hitting this turret. There's so much damage available to them, but they're so afraid of Shockwave that nothing gets done.
The Shockwave would be pretty devastating, though.
Sure.
Your squishy AD carries.
Spread your ADs out, Arcane Shift it. Put some damage down. Thing is, they had the wards to know where the guys
blue
buff went. They knew it was a 5v3. Shockwave would not have turned in any kills.
Oh, Gleeb.
Loses his flash. Chris still on the chase, though.
Threw out the standard pretty early there. Just for some damage.
He's dead. Oh. Who's going to get it?
This is catch after catch.
Impaler does with the W. Niantatsu jumped on by Chris. No Shockwave here for this one.
TP by Macnoon. So he's no longer going to be pushing that top lane out. And it's a 4-on-5 again. Chris with the Ravenous Hydra. He also has the QSS, so he could eat a stun. He could eat the Macnoon ultimate. There's a lot of things here that are going really well for this lineup of
Ghosts. Wow, Macnoon, speaking of getting eaten, though, takes a whole bunch of damage from the Culling. Flash engage. Chris finds one. Is he going to get any more for this one? Nintendo going to fire back. A bit of damage. Shago catches the spider, though. He's going to back out, rooted in place, and apparently just put some damage down. Looks like bot lane 2-2, easy to kill. And Coast absolutely dominating now in game 4.
They just turned it on. It looks like we might have a 5-game set on our hands here between these two teams. It just seems to be all about that mid-game. Like early game, people can recover. People can run away with it, but it's like they rarely do. Then when you hit the mid-game, the focus on dragons in 4.20 and dragon fights has just been multiplied. You know, it's just exponential.
Yeah. Yeah, it's a big deal. It seems to be what these teams are really focused on. Of course, Tier 2 turrets are pretty hard to kill without regenerating shield, and Tier 3 are hard because they have a slowing armor penetration or armor shredding laser that, like, is hard to deal with. The turrets did get harder to kill, so teams aren't trying to kill them as much. Sheep getting away from this one. Who takes a bunch of damage, though. Out he jumps. Impaler is in the mix, but he might just go down. Just gets away. Chris in the back lines. Who he barely alive. Summoner Heal helping him stay afloat here, but now in comes Lissandra. Is it enough? Jess is knocked with the team. Down he goes. That's a 1-for-0. Gleeb takes a lot of damage. Finally will fall. 1-for-1. Who he is low, and Ghost just have the health bars to keep on chasing.
Chris
Flash
from
Chris. Oh, can he find that? Nice stun and a mash.
They need to back up right now.
He's almost dead. Can he get Sheep? Oh. Yes, he can. He will trade his life, I believe. No, yes, he will. Chris finally finds it. And now Macnoon very low. Good cocoon. 2 landed in a row by Nintendude. 2-for-2 in that fight.
That fight started with Jezzes still having his ultimate on cooldown. So when Impaler jumped in, it looked like a great spot to have the Orianna ultimate come out. The only problem was, it wasn't up.
Kind of being gained there. Impaler Mash, juggling the aggro, easy pickup. That is dragon number three now for Team Coast.
Yeah, and the Muramana completed now for Huhi, and his damage is just going to take a big leap there. Trying to get away, just heal, flash, Impaler. The ball's in a great spot, but he doesn't have Shockwave there. So they just have to push Huhi out of the fight. And a lot of this is just, boom. It's right off that burst onto Jezzes. He's been playing really safe this game, but the fact that he didn't have his ultimate and that contribution to the fight, had to just kind of rely on getting the ball edged up, and then he paid for it when Gleeb went in, and he just got blown up.
So now Team Coast, looking good overall. It feels like what was happening with Fusion at the very beginning of the day, where Coast would get a pick, Fusion would win the fight anyway somehow, they'd start out a 4v5 and then just get two more kills and be like, hey, this worked out just fine for us. Well, now it's Fusion who like seems like they're starting every fight nicely, but Coast just wins the battles anyway. They're up 17-9 in kills now. And life is just getting painful now for the Fusion roster. They've got to figure out what's going wrong, and quickly. They've only got one more game to spare. Assuming Coast can take this game down. They're looking for the Dragon now, 29 minutes in. Sorry, Baron, I should say. 7,000 gold lead. They are spotted. This is a known objective now.
Just got to keep Nintendo out of this fight. Like I always say, Baron smites 50-50.
There's Lissandra. Pops the ult. They find Mash, but down he goes right away. Chris makes the dunk happen. Random's Omen now on the guy. The Glarbo pops the ult, but there's no damage to be dealt. There's just nothing these guys can do. They're too afraid of that shockwave, of the re-engage, of Impaler coming in. The Glarbo will die for this one, and out goes Niantanso. Another 2-0. Coast just keep winning every battle.
Yeah, and Mac Noon didn't use his Zhonyas there, didn't have time, got blown up immediately, and Coast does a really good job of skirmishing after a team fight with low HP. Impaler jumps in, gets the CC. As soon as you target him, he's already walking backwards, and then you switch targets, and then he walks forwards again, and they just kind of tag team each other out. Mm-hmm. Like, it's like a weird kind of micromanaging between the team.
And it's just good stuff. I mean, it's really just impressive by Impaler. He's playing Rengar. One of the best I've ever seen in Western League of Legends. Especially the NALCS, they also tend to do it wrong. But Impaler's done such a good job of kiting things back and forth. He just never goes down.
Oh, he still went through with the teleport, but look at that. He didn't even get it off. No Zhonya's there.
He was just trying to get damage on Mash. And
yeah.
He could have Zhonya's.
He threw out the glacial path for some damage there, but he just got blown up. And look at that. Chris goes backwards, Impaler goes backwards, and then it's just Mash comes in, and as soon as he gets targeted, he's back on the back line again.
Yeah, buff will go to Impaler. He's looking pretty happy. Did go Warrior Enchant, by the way. You could think that he might go for the, you know, the old Feral Flare style.
The Devourer.
Devourer, but no, it is the AD and Armor Pen. That's the build he's going for, and then right into tank. He has Locket, and then the items that make Locket again. Like, I don't know what goes into Kindle Gem
Visage.
Ruby Crystal. Oh yeah, Visage, good call. Thanks.
Yep.
I almost always buy like the Null Magic Mantle on that one, so I never realized like that's an item path for that.
Yeah, it's the
Yeah, you're right, it's Visage. Oh, jump in though. MacNoon's gotta be careful. Does get out with the path though. Except for catching them for the slow. Mash taking some damage.
Impaler.
There's the engage though. Impaler wants something. Doesn't quite find it. There's the empowered stun, and Gleeb Glarbo forced to ult to stay alive here. Now can they re-engage?
Ball
can MacNoon stay alive? MacNoon jumps on in, finds the Zhonya's, finds the ult on Mash. Can they kill him? Not quite! Nien is trying! He gets the damage, but it's two kills already for Coast. Now Nintendo forced to run away, just in the mix there with the shield, finding a whole bunch to do, but they do finally trade one back. But now Niantanso will die to Impaler for the cleanup. 4-2 here. Make that 5-2. Coast inside the base, forced to run out of it though.
And the ace there, and once again, the team fighting prowess of Coast in these mid-game compositions is just really scary. Jezz's ball placement, getting two people on the back line in a shockwave, it was really hard to even pay attention to where he was positioning himself and his ball during that fight, because he was completely off to the right while everything was happening to the left. Just, if you're playing against this, it's so...
You saw that? That was great. He was killing a ward over the wall. That was cute.
Oh. Yeah, so the ball is actually on Impaler there, and then Jezzes wraps around under the right, flashes in.
Wow, nice.
And then repositions it. it's so hard because you're paying attention to this bush that has the pick ward in it, and the, where the AD carry is, where Mash is, the big threat on Coast. And Jez says, you know what, I'm still here, and immediately turns that back line into goo.
Flash QRW kind of secures those three squishy kills in the back there. Nicely done for him. Coast now up 13 kills and 9,000 gold in this one. Great stun, root by Impaler. Gleeblarby will ult to try to stay alive, but it will be enough.
Yeah, just the call to go back right afterwards. They got him to half HP, and they're okay with it. A little bunny hop from Impaler earlier cracked me up. Woo! That's how we went over.
Yep. Yeah, it was a ward right against the cliff there, and there wasn't enough space for him to get over the wall, but it still counted as him auto-attacking the ward. That was interesting. I've never seen that before. Uh-oh, Neotanzo. Okay, good. Saved the Valkyrie for long enough to not die. Stun onto Impaler, but he's too tanky to go down. They just... nothing can be done here. And the problem is there's no Infinity Edge by either AD carry, so they don't kill the front line anymore. This is not good. There's the push on
in. Chris
in the front lines. Macnoon wants this to happen, but I don't know if it's going to be enough. He's by himself. He pops his own as he buys some time, but they're going to leave him out to dry. Oh, close.
That last crit at the very end. Man, he came in, immediately disengaged from Sheep.
Yep.
Like, that was perfectly timed, because if he had done it too early, wouldn't have pushed him back. And he did it right on time, and then he had to ulti himself, and that ultimate didn't do any damage.
No. And the thing is, this comp does no damage. The Triforce Power Spike passed, and then neither went for IF second. And so they're just, there is no damage output from this team comp. Nothing gets done by Fusion.
It's all spell slinging with like one auto attack, and it's not going to be a crit.
Yeah, but problem is spells don't kill tanks.
Yeah,
they never kill tanks. Crits kill tanks, right. And it's not going to happen. He forced to jump away. Ooh. Nice pickup by Chris. And now he's too tanky. Randuin's in almost the Frozen Heart now as well. There is no way Mystic Shot ever does anything here.
Wow, this is just a crazy series we have on our hands. They finally go after this Baron, but look at that, Macnoon.
Not gonna matter.
Homeguarding in with the teleport, desperately trying to make a play for his team.
He's gonna try, ooh, good shockwave, Jessica's ulted. Actually, that's some pretty nice pain, but it's just not nearly enough. Nintendo now will look for the steal. Can he get it? 3,000 health in this one. Oh, actually, nice plays by Neontanzo. And they're gonna stop Baron, one for one, nicely done.
Yeah, Nintendo is right on the side, and he has Smite up. Although he's three levels down on Impaler, it's still a risk you don't want to take.
You always got to be careful that one, level 12 to 15. And Nintendo, look at this one, can maybe sneak in this Scuttler. Rather get the pink ward, probably the right choice.
Like, Nintendo is 2-1-4. Like, his score line looks pretty decent.
Yeah.
But then you compare it to what Impaler's been doing in this entire game.
Oh, man.
The 8-2-10 and the experience from kills, which is really big right now. Very impactful, because the levels just across the board, Impaler is the same level as the mid laner on Fusion, and his own mid laner. He's very ahead of the curve.
So far, so good for Team Coast. The re-engage has forced Nintendo away. Good repel to the red buff, though. Impaler now locked up for a big leap. Glarbu in bad shape, though. He will go down through the ultimate. And a quick red buff grab by Mash. No concerns at all. Team Coast just... wherever they go, kills seem to just happen.
They're getting tons of options here, too. They're 11k gold up. They have all the outer turrets out done except for those inner lines. Dragon, they're on their fourth one. The next one will be their fifth, and Baron is up, and they can take it right now because Nintendo, nowhere around. He's up top. They could burst this down in just a second.
Let's attempt at steal. Elise not going to quite get it. The smite comes in a little bit early from Impaler. And it's not going to be a steal at all from Nintendo.
Nope. Very close. He had to flash out, though. That's his flash down. And he's already pretty squishy in this game because there's just so much damage on Coast's side. Like, even Impaler is like, strangely enough, he's kind of a damage threat because of the levels that he has.
Oh, sure. And especially with 30% CDR in his build so far, plus you assume probably 10% from Runes and Masteries.
He's also got the Baron buff on himself, and he has the Elixir that gives him more damage. So he's sitting at 252 damage.
Yeah, 252 AD. He does have 40% CDR. He's going to spam abilities all day, all night. His Q's doing 400-something damage even before being empowered.
He is at 19 stacks on his Bone Tooth. This will
this
be his
20th. This could be 20th. Macnoon taking a lot of damage. Does have Zonya's. Can he stay away from this one, though? Flash, there's the kill. Impaler, 20 stacks. Move speed while stealth during his ultimate is doubled. Yeah, this is going to be painful.
Yeah, he can just rush into the back line extremely quickly. Even if it's through a turret, it's really fast and hard to disengage that they could dive with that. And the fact that he built tank afterwards is just going to help him even more. And the fact that they have this 10-1 and 13 Mash, who's had an amazing game.
Oh, man.
He loses in CS to Nien Tanso almost all the time, but that's because they funnel so much into Nien.
Yeah.
But...
Ooh, three-man Shockwave in goes Chris. They're going to find kills in a second. First Inhib turret goes down. So does Nintendude. Already a 1-0. Mechnum is already gone. Re-engage. Impaler finds another. He's just unable to be stopped here. 9-2 and 12. This is going to be the game.
He's going to tank it.
38, 25 minions are there. Baron buff is there. Coast bring it 2-2. I don't see this defense quite working, but maybe they've got a chance. Back Noon pops Zonius. They're waiting around him. He's going to go down right away. Another kill picked up. 2v5 in the base now. Coast looking for turret number 2. Can they make this one fall? Looks like the answer is yes. Out goes Nien Tanso. He's going to fall down. There's the Nexus, the fist pump from Jesses, and they say, guys, one more game, and we get the LCS.
Their backs were against the wall. Down 2-0, and now it's back to 2-2, and it is match point for either team. Deciding game, in one more game, one of these teams will be in the LCS for the 2015 Spring Split.
And the other will know that they were in arm's reach away and are going to have to wait until the Summer Split to qualify. They're going to be moving themselves into the Challenger Series if you lose right here. So now both teams got to collect themselves. They got to talk to their staff, they got to talk to their coaches, and bounce back. So Coast already did it. They lost two games straight. They bounced back.
Yeah.
Fusion had done that before against Final Five, lost two games straight, bounced back. But now, who's going to be able to recover properly? Who's going to have what it takes to go into Game 5? Who picks the right champions? Who makes the right plays? Let's see what happens.
I feel like Coast have more of the momentum coming into this because of the recent wins and the fact that they had that camaraderie of they just overcame a 2-0 deficit to bring it back to even. Is really big as opposed to the people who, when you are up, and I've been in this situation before, 2-0 over your opponent and they start coming back, you get more scared.
Yeah.
You start freaking out and you start blaming yourself because you're like, we could have ended this a game ago. We could have ended this two games ago.
Sure.
And you start beating yourself up and they can't have that mentality. They have to just be like, all right, you know, it's best of one now. Mm-hmm. And we've already beaten them twice, so we know we can do it.
Right.
So they got to stick to their guns. I think mid-game compositions suit both of these teams appropriately, mid-game fight compositions.
Rumble's undefeated in this series.
Exactly.
And I think it's for a pretty big reason here. I think that's definitely a possibility. We look for this champion being a high priority. That said, it wasn't even picked last game, so these teams both have other things in mind for them. Now, that said as well, both these teams, we're talking about bouncing back from deficits. Yeah. They've got big support staffs, right? They've got a lot of people back there. Almost the entirety of the Fusion organization is here, minus two people. There's actually more guys backstage than actually in the playing field for these guys, like there to cheer them on. So both these teams, I think, have what it takes. I want to see who just brings it a little bit better. Game 5's coming up soon, guys. The final, the decider for who joins at the LCS will be here.